Kant called one version of it an old formula of the schools. There are many motivations for the idea. First, it offers a way to explain what's distinctive of action and agency. Guidance by evaluation has been thought to be essential to what makes a movement mine, what makes it attributable to me as a person, rather than the product of mechanistically conceived desires operating in or through me. Second, it offers a unified picture of action and belief. Both are trying to get things right. Belief with respect to the true, action with respect to the good. Third, it lets a single explanation account for evaluation and motivation at the same time. It doesn't leave why you did something and why you thought it was good only contingently related. If we act under the guise of the good, we can explain why someone does something by explaining what she saw as good about it. Or if we don't see how to explain something perplexing that someone did, we can start by looking for the unobvious evaluative element. Fourth, as I think Aristotle and Kant saw, it offers a hope for a foundation for ethics. If we all pursue what we see as good, a conclusion about the nature of the good will have an inescapable normative claim on us. That's a foundational hope that I share but won't go into here. And lastly, a guise of the good view is an extension of ordinary generosity or charity of interpretation. Many of us think it's kind to others and to ourselves to interpret their motivations in the best light we can. It's a good idea to consider that a compliment might be genuinely appreciative rather than a piece of self-serving flattery. We can try to remember that a thief or an addict or an obnoxious colleague is at bottom doing the best he can under difficult circumstances. A guise of the good view is a kind of generosity of interpretation on a grand scale, systematized into a view about acting beings. It says that even when we're conflicted or confused or exhausted, we pursue what we see as good. These theoretical and practical motivations are not what this talk is about. So I'm not going to make an argument today about their legitimacy or their uniqueness to a guise of the good view. I mentioned them just to give you a sense of why the view is worth considering. What I'm going to do in the talk is defend the view itself on one of the key issues on which it needs defending. At least on the face of it, it can seem obvious that we often do and want what we do not see as good, and sometimes even what we see as bad. We can be malicious, perverse, compulsive, self-destructive, indifferent, or in conflict with our own better judgment. Arguably, some creatures who act are not even old enough, or not even of the right species, to have or use evaluative concepts. The classical view then seems to paint an impoverished picture, leaving out these widespread and important forms of activity. It seems to describe only, as David Velleman put it, a particular species of agent, and a particularly bland species of agent at that. If that's right, a view like that can't capture anything general about personhood or motivation. And clinging to a guise of the good view would be an extension not of ordinary, reasonable generosity of interpretation of people, but of a blind optimism that fails to see the person it's trying to be kind to. I believe the guise of the good view, properly understood, can account for the wide variety of agency while doing justice to the motivations I mentioned. In this talk, I want to propose a new way for the view to handle what's often taken to be the central counterexample, akrasia, or acting against one's own better judgment. I'm going to focus on the view as applied to intentional action. And rather than going through various possible formulations, which there are very many, I'll focus on one especially ambitious version of the view. We can call this version the normative belief requirement. This is on the handout. The normative belief requirement says that if A acts intentionally, A must believe she ought to X. So the requirement is not just that A see something or other good in Xing, or even see it as a good thing to do. nor is it that Ek Sing must appear to A to be good. She must believe her Ek Sing to be good overall, in the sense that she ought to do it. I'll occasionally use should as a synonym for ought, and I'll soon consider a discussion that focuses on judgment rather than belief. But my main concern will be the normative belief requirement. I'll try to show that there's conceptual room for a credit action, even if this requirement is correct. Here's the problem. It's hard to deny that we sometimes intentionally do what we believe we ought not do. These actions are often called Socratic, or sometimes weak-willed, or against one's own better judgment. For someone to do something Socratically, so for A to X Socratically, is for A to X intentionally, while believing she ought not X. We believe, for example, that we should not eat dessert, or not stay on the computer, or not insult our friend. But we do it anyway. That seems to go directly against the normative belief requirement, which requires normative endorsement, not rejection or indifference. If we act acratically, how could any such view be true? How can evaluation and motivation line up so neatly if they so obviously come apart? I'm going to answer this question in two parts. I'll first explain why the challenge is important, but different and less intractable than it seems to be. Then I'll address the challenge. I'm going to argue that the explanation of acratic action lies in conflicting normative beliefs. We intentionally do what we believe we ought not do because we also believe that we ought to do it. Okay, section two. So it seems clear that we can believe we ought not do something and still do it anyway. How could anyone deny that? The key initial point is that the normative belief requirement doesn't make any denial like that. It just doesn't hold that intentional action precludes negative evaluation. Instead, it attributes a positive evaluation, a belief that we ought to act as we do. We should in general distinguish not believing from believing not. That is, we should distinguish not believing one ought to eat dessert from believing one ought not eat it. We should distinguish lacking a positive normative belief from having a quote-unquote negative one, or believing in a prohibition. The normative belief requirement requires a belief that we ought to act as we do. When we act acratically, we believe we ought not act as we do. That's different than not believing we ought to act as we do. So, strictly speaking, in a way, there is no problem about believing we ought not do something and doing it anyway. There's always the possibility of believing that one ought to and believing that one ought not. Acrisia is possible when we have conflicting normative beliefs. So to bring this out, consider Donald Davidson's classic account of acrisia. In How is Weakness of the Will Possible?, Davidson describes the problem as a conflict between three principles that all, as he says, seem self-evident. These are all in the handout I'll read them out. P1, if an agent wants to do X more than Y and believes himself free to do either, he will intentionally do X if he does either intentionally. P2, if an agent judges it better to do X than Y, he wants to do X more than to do Y. P3, there are incontinent actions. P3 just restates what it seems we already knew, that it's possible to act intentionally against one's own better judgment. In Davidson's terms, I'll quote his definition, in doing X, an agent acts incontinently if and only if A, the agent does X intentionally, B, the agent believes there's an alternative action Y open to him, and C, the agent judges that all things considered, it would be better to do Y than to do X. P3 just tells us that we do sometimes act this way. And yet, the existence of such actions seems to fly in the face of, quote, another doctrine that has an air of self-evidence, that insofar as a person acts intentionally, he acts in the light of some imagined good, end quote. P1 and P2 together reflect that other doctrine. Davidson thinks the conflict cannot be resolved. Quote, no amount of tinkering with P1 to P3 will remove the underlying problem, end quote. He then goes on to develop a conception of akrasia that attempts to preserve all three principles. P2, which connects judgment with wanting, is the principle that most directly expresses a guise of the good view. It's been common to resist guise of the good views by rejecting P2. That can seem to be the most natural line of resistance, and it's been taken in some now classic treatments of akratic action by Robert Audi, Alfred Neely, David Pears, and Gary Watson. But I think that rejecting P2 is a misguided way of resisting a guise of the good view. It's misguided because a guise of the good view should itself reject P2. P2 says, if an agent judges it better to do X than Y, he wants to do X more than to do Y. By the same token, if an agent judges it better to do Y than X, she wants to do Y more than to do X. That's just switching variables. So if her judgments conflict, if she judges both that it's better to do X than to do Y, and that it's better to do Y than to do X, then she must both want to do X more than to do Y, and want to do Y more than to do X. That's not just irrational, it's impossible. Two desires can't each be stronger than the other. So if P2 is right, it's impossible both to judge it better to do X than Y, and to judge the contrary. So I think that's a mistake. I think it's a mistake to have that kind of implication. And to avoid that kind of mistake, we can formulate a constraint on conceptions of akrasia. Let's call it the conflict constraint. This is on the handout too. An accurate conception of akrasia must allow that a person can both believe she ought to do something and believe she ought not do it. That's the conflict constraint. The conflict constraint insists that we allow the possibility of conflicting normative beliefs. Beliefs that together require both performing an action and not performing it. I call it the conflict constraint rather than the contradiction constraint, because what's most directly at issue is not contradictory beliefs of the form P and not P, but normative conflict of the form I ought to X and I ought not X. A conflict like that both requires and forbids an action, rather than requiring the action and denying the requirement. There are two available senses of conflict in belief here. We can distinguish conflict within a belief and conflict between beliefs. A single belief can show normative conflict if the belief is of the form, I ought to X and I ought not X. That's all one thing that you believe. A sharp conflict of that kind can be seen in Thomas Nagel's essay, War and Massacre. Nagel describes some especially stark moral dilemmas related to war, such as the question of whether to torture a terrorist. He thinks that situations like those can put us into what he calls a moral blind alley, in which, for example, torturing the terrorist would be wrong, and not torturing the terrorist would be wrong. He writes, quote, the idea of a moral blind alley is a perfectly intelligible one. It is possible to get into such a situation by one's own fault, and people do it all the time. If, for example, one makes two incompatible promises or commitments, becomes engaged to two people, for example, then there is no course one can take which is not wrong, but one must break one's promise to at least one of them. Making a clean breast of the whole thing will not be enough to remove one's reprehensibility. The existence of such cases is not morally disturbing, however, because we feel that the situation was not unavoidable. One had to do something wrong in the first place to get into it. This is all still quoting Nagel. But what if the world itself, or someone else's actions, could face a previously innocent person with a choice between morally abominable courses of action, and leave him no way to escape with his honor? Our intuitions rebel at the idea, for we feel that the constructability of such a case must show a contradiction in our moral views. But it is not in itself a contradiction to say that someone can do X or not do X, and that for him to take either course would be wrong. It merely contradicts the supposition that ought implies can, since presumably one ought to refrain from what is wrong, and in such a case it is impossible to do so." End quote. I'm quoting this passage not to agree or disagree with it, but simply to point out that Nagel himself seems to believe it. He suggests that it can be true that doing X or not doing X can both be wrong, in the sense that one ought not do X and ought not not do X. And so it seems Nagel believes that in some situations we ought to X and ought not X for some X. About particular situations, he might have beliefs with the content like, I ought to torture the terrorist and I ought not torture him. Since Nagel seems to have in mind a genuinely normative ought, rather than a specifically moral but normatively escapable one, we can talk directly of normative blind alleys. To endorse the possibility of a normative blind alley is to explicitly endorse the possibility that a belief with a within-belief normative conflict can be true. To believe oneself to be in a normative blind alley in a particular case is to have a within-belief normative conflict. For normative conflict between beliefs, it's enough to have a belief of the form, I ought to X, and a belief of the form, I ought not X. Those beliefs are a normative conflict with each other, even without a belief in the conjunction, I ought to X and I ought not X. The possibility of within-belief conflict, it's natural to think, entails the possibility of between-belief conflict. Most of us think that belief distributes over conjuncts, that someone who believes P and Q believes P and believes Q. And even if belief did not distribute over conjuncts, someone is usually able to infer each conjunct from the conjunction. Someone who believes herself to be in a normative blind alley believes in, or at any rate can infer, each of its components. The inference in the other direction can be harder. An anorexic who believes I should lose weight and believes I should not lose weight might find it far from trivial to form the conjunctive belief, I should lose weight and I should not lose weight. Within belief normative conflict can be harder to maintain than between belief conflict, and on a more restricted view, it might not be possible. Some of you might think that normative blind alleys make so little sense that even Nagel himself couldn't understand the idea well enough to count as ever believing himself to be in one. If you think that, we can still go on. I'm considering within-belief conflict to distinguish it from between-belief conflict, to give a sense of what it might be like, and to mention that accepting its possibility would likely lead us to accepting the possibility of between-belief conflict, too. But for those of us who doubt the possibility of within-belief conflict, we can leave it aside. What the conflict constraint, and I think the normative belief requirement, require is only the possibility of normative conflict between beliefs. Why think even that much conflict is possible? Or to ask this another way, in a conflict situation, why think both beliefs, quote unquote, count as beliefs? I won't try to go through every view of the nature of belief here. But when it comes to attributing a belief to someone, we tend to look to a cluster of typical marks of belief. We look for sensitivity to evidence or to apparent evidence, recall in relevant circumstances, felt conviction, a disposition to report the belief to others, use of the belief in further reasoning. In, for example, conflict about weight loss, each of two beliefs can manifest these characteristic features. Or if you think only two or three of those features are essential, each belief can manifest those. Each might be sensitive to apparent evidence. One to an apparent horrible overabundance of fat seen in the mirror, the other to a doctor's warnings of malnutrition. Each might be reported sincerely in various contexts and to different people, recalled often and with conviction at various times, and so on. And it's not always easy to settle on a single belief attribution statistically, based on just a greater frequency or duration of dominance of one overly anorexic belief over a healthy one, or vice versa. Someone's thoughts and behavior can be so starkly contradictory that it can be described only by attributing two conflicting normative beliefs to him. This can be true, even though it can be difficult for him to combine these beliefs into a single perspective. I should lose weight and I should not lose weight is much harder to support with evidence, to hold with any conviction, to sincerely report, and so on. Between belief conflict is easier to maintain and more resistant to resolution. So, although accepting the possibility of within belief conflict is one way to accept the possibility of between belief conflict, it's not the only way. The usual characteristics by which we recognize belief can themselves conflict, and can call for the attribution of two conflicting beliefs. I defend the possibility of normative conflict between beliefs in more detail elsewhere, and I'd be happy to talk about it more in the Q&A. But for the rest of this talk, I'm going to assume that normative conflict between beliefs is possible, and that the conflict constraint is true. That's a view that can be accepted regardless of what one thinks of the guise of the good view of action. And I think it's a help, not a hindrance, to a guise of the good view. Respecting the constraint helps the view allow an important kind of inconsistency, and so helps it avoid limiting itself to describing a particularly bland species of agent, as Valerie put it. I think it's the denial of the possibility of conflicting normative beliefs that describes a particularly bland species of agent, and insists on a naive optimism about the coherence of our attitudes. And yet, Davidson's formulation of his principles in How is Weakness of the Will Possible can lead us to unwittingly accept a view that violates the constraint. His P2 is close to a blanket denial of the possibility of conflicting beliefs about what one ought to do. Once we let go of that optimism, I think, a guise of the good view becomes defensible. The problem of Socratic action is, how can one believe that one ought not do something, and still intentionally do it? In one way, the problem has an easy answer, even if we accept the normative belief requirement. We intentionally do it, take an extra helping of ice cream, for example, because we do believe we ought to, and we act on that belief. Believing we ought to do something does not stop us from also believing we ought not. Unfortunately, believing we ought not doesn't stop us from believing we ought to, either. We can act acratically because our beliefs can conflict in that way. So the basic idea, once again, is that akrasia itself involves belief that conflicts with our better judgment. Reaching for dessert has an evaluative structure. Typically, the dessert suddenly strikes us as delicious and is something we ought to have, even if we disapprove of our own motivation and believe we ought to skip dessert. The possibility of conflicting beliefs takes some of the bite out of the counterexample. It prevents akrasia from providing a direct refutation of the normative belief requirement. So the possibility of conflict makes accounting for akrasia difficult instead of impossible. But akrasia still presents a challenge. Although the normative belief requirement can allow that we can do what we believe we ought not to, it does deny that we can do what we do not believe we ought to. It then must hold that whenever we intentionally do what we believe we ought not do, we must also believe that we ought. It has to hold, in other words, that akrasia always involves conflicting normative beliefs. My challenge is to defend that view. Okay, on to section 3. So we can call the view of defending the conflicting belief view. It just says, akratic action requires conflicting normative beliefs. Though this view is rarely taken seriously, I think it is defensible. And the rest of this talk, I'm going to develop it by responding to some natural objections. So first of all, is the view explanatory? One might think that pointing to conflicting beliefs could not even in principle provide an account of akrasia. It wouldn't explain how that conflict is possible. So how would it explain how action can be Socratic? I think this objection is right in wanting more explanation, but wrong to want it here. The conflicting belief view holds the promise of reducing one problem, how can action be Socratic, to another, how can we have conflicting normative beliefs? Most of us think we already had the second problem. We're then left with one problem where there were two, and we see why an understanding of Socratic action depends on an understanding of normative conflict between beliefs. That, I think, is genuinely explanatory. Most importantly, it's enough to address the problem Marcosia poses for the normative belief requirement. The problem was that the requirement seems to rule out the possibility of Marcosia. The answer is that it does not. It can explain Marcosia by a kind of conflict in belief. Most of us already agree that such conflict is possible, though we might not yet fully understand how. That, I'm arguing, is the beauty of noticing the possibility of such conflict, or accepting the conflict constraint. It's minimal enough to accept, powerful enough to dispel doubts about Apersia, and interesting enough to get us thinking about how it can be true. On to the second objection. Though we often act acratically, if we were riddled with such conflicting beliefs every time, would we be rational beings at all? Can agents in general be that contradictory or that in conflict? To see how we would be rational beings, we can start by asking how many conflicts would create a problem. So are we talking about 100 or a million? A concern about widespread conflict in normative belief is partly a concern about the possibility of any conflict. We lose our picture of fully unified agency as soon as we accept the conflict constraint. Beyond that point, increasing disunity can also be increasingly disconcerting. As Davidson puts it in Paradoxes of Rationality, quote, it is a matter of degree. We have no trouble understanding small perturbations against a background with which we are largely in sympathy. But large deviations from reality or consistency begin to undermine our ability to describe and explain what is going on in mental terms. The deviations might look somewhat larger when we think about Garcia as involving conflicting normative beliefs. But the difference is not in allowing that we do have such conflicting beliefs. Any view that satisfies the conflict constraint does that. Any plausible view of the mind, I think, will have to allow some conflict normative beliefs. Nor is the difference in the number of Socratic cases, which are already natural to describe as involving some kind of disunity. The difference is in seeing a conflict between beliefs more often than other views do. That does sharpen the disunity, but there's so far no reason to think that it makes the difference between someone who's recognizably an agent and something that's not. Instead, I think bringing out the extent of the disunity is an advantage of explaining Akrasia in terms of conflict. If we accept the possibility of conflicting normative beliefs in general and start to see them here, we've helped to explain why Socratic action is so puzzling in the first place. It's puzzling, at least in part, in the same way that conflicting beliefs are puzzling. It's puzzling that one can be so disunified and still be a single person. On to the third objection. Even if so much conflict is possible, you might wonder, is it really plausible to think that all akrasia involves conflicting normative beliefs? When one doubts that akrasia must involve conflicting normative beliefs, the alternative must be that at least one of the two conflicting beliefs is lacking. The doubt doesn't imagine the better or prohibitive belief to be lacking. That belief is essential to the phenomenon of acting against one's better judgment, or acting as we believe we ought not act. So, the doubt must be about the quote-unquote worse belief. One doubts whether the person must believe she ought to act as she does. That doubt is not specific to akrasia. To be specific to akrasia, Its guiding idea would have to be that an action may not be motivated or accompanied by a normative belief when the person has a conflicting belief. Why would the conflicting belief make the difference? The thought might be that one cannot endorse an action that one believes one ought not perform. But to think this is to violate the conflict constraint. It's to rule out the possibility of conflicting normative beliefs in cases of acratic action. If the objection does not depend on the presence of a better belief, it's not an objection to the guise of the good view's account of akrasia. It's a general doubt about the view. Rather than threatening the account of acratic action or rendering akrasia distinctively problematic, it expresses skepticism about the view as a whole. In that case, the way to address the objection is to take on the larger issue of which I'm treating one smaller part in this talk. It's to think through the motivations and the difficulties of the view and see whether there's a substantive and defensible version of it. There's no distinctive problem about akrasia. On to the fourth objection. According to Aristotle, what produces movement is always either good or the apparent good. But, according to us, what we ourselves do is often not good, or not what we ought to do. Akrasia seems puzzling, largely because, when we act acratically, it seems clear to each of us that we do what we do not believe we ought to. It then seems that the normative belief requirement flies in the face of our own experience. The requirement seems forced to attribute widespread error to people about their own beliefs. I call that the error attribution problem. Does pointing to a conflicting belief avoid the problem? People seem to often experience themselves intentionally doing what they clearly do not believe they ought to. People even say so. They say, "I don't think I should be doing this." The normative belief requirement says they do think they should be doing it. Why should we believe the normative belief requirement and not the person? I think the normative belief requirement attributes fewer mistakes than it seems to. The grammar makes the problem seem worse than it is. If you say, "I don't think he's being a good friend," that doesn't usually report an absence of belief. It reports a belief. Normally, the speaker does believe that the he in the statement is not being a good friend. "I don't think we should hire him" is not an expression of indifference or hesitation, but a way of saying, "Let's not hire him." "I don't think I should be doing this" often means, "I think I shouldn't be doing this." As before, that's consistent with the normative belief requirement. The requirement only holds that the person must also have a contrary belief. We can still imagine someone saying, "Trust me, I don't believe at all that I should be doing this." It's a point in favor of the normative belief requirement that assertions like that are rare. As Aristotle put it, such a value of clarity without a practical change of mind seems extraordinary. Even when someone does say this, does say, "Trust me, I don't believe at all that I should be doing this," it can often be insincere. It can also be a grammatically misleading expression of strong disapproval rather than lack of approval. "So I believe very strongly that I shouldn't be doing this." In other cases, the person might be right because the action is not intentional. It might be a bare reflex, or the involuntary cursing of someone with Tourette's syndrome, or a more complex compulsive movement like an alien hand syndrome, of which the person is an alienated observer. So saying, "Trust me, I don't believe at all that I should be doing this," can be a lie, or a joke, or an expression of self-blame, or it can be straightforwardly true and unproblematic because the action is not intentional. I think we should accept that it might not be any of these. The normative belief requirement is threatened if it's forced to see people as systematically mistaken about their own beliefs. It doesn't have to say that we're never mistaken about our beliefs. That extent of infallibility is unlikely, and a view that denies it is not at a disadvantage. So I think we can and should say that in some special cases, we can be mistaken about what we believe. Here, acknowledging the possibility of conflicting beliefs helps in two ways. First, it helps us see that the normative belief requirement attributes error not in ascribing a belief to oneself, but only in denying that we have a belief. If we seem to ourselves to obviously have some normative belief, the requirement will never disagree with us. This makes the range of attributed error smaller by limiting the attributed error to error in denial. Second, mistakes are especially likely in the presence of conflicting beliefs, either of which can make the other easier to miss or deny. Some of us might be assuming when we act erratically that since we believe we ought not do something, we do not believe that we ought. When most of us think conflicting beliefs are possible, we tend to ignore the possibility in our own activity. Pointing to the possibility of conflict offers an error theory to account for our overstep. So in sum, the error attribution problem is powerful when the attributed error is extremely widespread. The normative belief requirement attributes error in a small range of special cases. That, I think, is the right view. We're neither systematically mistaken, nor always aware of what we ourselves believe. One last objection. We often describe akrasia as action against one's better judgments. I've been doing scare quotes around better for a while. But the way I described it, it seems to include intentional action against any judgment. Or to put it differently, any intentional action in a case of conflicting beliefs about what we ought to do. If we believe we should go to the beach and believe we shouldn't go, anything we do will conflict with something we believe. To put it yet another way, neither belief seems in any way singled out as the better one. Both are treated as on the same footing. Explaining akrasia in terms of conflicting beliefs can then seem to leave out an essential asymmetry in a person's relations to her better belief and her conflicting belief that she ought to act as she does. I call this the asymmetry problem. By itself, pointing to conflicting beliefs says nothing at all about asymmetry or asymmetry. It does rule out one obvious possible asymmetry, that one potential action is believed to be what we ought to do, and another is not. But otherwise, it leaves the issue open to the other features we might have in mind when we talk about a better judgment. We often speak of the better judgment as a more considered or all things considered judgment, which takes into account the full range of relevant considerations. I might see that overall I ought to stop eating, and when I take a dessert anyway, my reasoning is likely to take less into account. We might also have in mind that a better judgment is the one that we, on reflection, more strongly endorse or identify with. We might also sometimes mean the judgment that's more reasonable, or more likely to be correct, or actually better. Though the range of evidence taken into consideration is one central dimension of asymmetry, it's worth remembering that the normative belief requirement can allow for any of these other asymmetries. In practice, the degree of asymmetry in any of these senses can vary. To illustrate this, I want to end with a more complex example of akrasia. It's a little more complex, I just put it on my handout too. I call this family values. So someone must call me James. James is opposed to same-sex relationships. His considered belief is that we ought to do what's good for our species and not go against nature. He's also vegetarian, but he hasn't thought about why, and he's taken aback when the connection to his other views is pointed out to him. It's kind of surprising to people that the considerations against homosexuality tend to also work against vegetarianism. So he has this surprising moment. Because he believes that eating meat is natural and good for our species, he decides to give up vegetarianism. But that evening, he can't bring himself to try meat. Okay, so James has decided that he ought to eat meat.
but theocratically refrains. His case is complicated. His stated speciesist belief might itself be theocratic. He might have a deeper belief in the sanctity of life and in the importance of letting every living creature live and flourish without interference, which comes out vividly in many other contexts, supports his vegetarianism, and conflicts with disregard for animal life in general. In that case, his stated principle is more local than he thinks, and might be little more than a rationalization of his homophobic feelings. We don't know exactly how much he's considered or where his deeper commitments lie. But if I'm right, imagining James as genuinely acratic at his vegetarian dinner is imagining him with two conflicting beliefs, that he ought to eat meat and that he ought not, to which his relation is probably asymmetrical in various ways. The relevant beliefs can vary in important and subtle ways in their responsiveness to evidence, reasonableness, depth in various senses, strength of identification, and other features. The normative belief requirement can allow for any of these various kinds of asymmetry. In rejecting Guys of the Good Views, David Velleman writes that he hopes, quote, for a moral psychology that can make room for the whole motley crew, end quote, of acting creatures. Michael Stocker writes in his essay Desiring the Bad, quote, philosophical theories have depicted the psyche, especially the interrelations between motivation and evaluation, as far too simple, far too unified, and far too rational, end quote. I think that some of our theories have depicted evaluation itself as far too simple, far too unified, and far too rational. Even the theories that explicitly allow for the possibility of conflicts in evaluation rarely do justice to the details or the metaphysical implications of those conflicts. I've tried to make more room for the motley crew of acting creatures by insisting on the complexities of evaluation, and especially of normative belief. And I've argued that it's naivete about the coherence of our normative beliefs, not about their connection to intentional action, that we should be exercising from our understanding of ourselves. Once we do that, even an ambitious view like the normative belief requirement becomes defensible. I think the lesson is more general, that a necessary connection between intentional beliefs can offer a general account of acratic action under the guise of the good.
Break for coffee and cookies, and if you're Moses, and return 10 past.